Hello and welcome back. We're on to section four now. Things that don't work. Actually, things that haven't worked too well. In the previous section, section three, we did have a look at a lot of underfloor insulation products which are available on the market at the moment. So, in this section, we're going to see how some of them have performed over time, so that you can better decide what products you might not want to use. Anyway, let's get started with that. We start with concertina foil bats. Now, I think I mentioned earlier that I actually like this product in some situations, specifically in roofs that have a very small space to insulate in. So cathedral roofs and flat metal deck roofs where you're going to lift the cladding and put insulation in. Concertina foil bats are really good in conjunction with some bulk insulation in order to achieve the best possible R value in a small space. But underfloor may not be their finest hour. What we see here is, concertina foil bats fitted under a floor. And you can see, if you look here is a bat. It probably ends up there somewhere because there's lapped over with another bat. So they're bat length and you lap them, and that's how you insulate the floor. They're stapled to the lower edge of the joists, so that's good. But what happens is this. So in the documentation for concertina foil bats for underfloor, they're drawn perfectly horizontally, like this, across here, perfectly horizontally. And gravity gets in the way because it's actually impossible to fit them like in the drawing. The other thing that I think is impossible, maybe it's not completely impossible, but it's highly improbable, is that where you lap one with the other, the pleats are going to line up precisely and give you a still airspace between the foil bats and the floor. Remember, reflective insulation only works if you have a still airspace between the reflective part and the floor. So I think you can see here that it's actually really, really difficult, if not impossible, to actually lap the concertina foils correctly under a floor. And this is unlikely to be very effective at all, okay? Because giant holes in the cover mean no still airspace, and therefore, well, we don't know what R value, if any, is actually being provided by this product in this situation. So, personally, I wouldn't use them under a floor. There's another picture on top of the foil bat and looking at the floor. It's a great hiding hole for rodents, that's for sure. So that's concertina foil bats. Probably not great for underfloor, I would suggest. Here we've got some foil-faced board. I don't know exactly which product it is, whether it's foil board or someone else's product. It probably doesn't matter so much. It's foil-faced board. It's extruded polystyrene with aluminium foil bonded to each side. And it really highlights some of the problems working with board under a floor. Does not lend itself well to retrofit situations. In new build, yes, maybe it's a great system. They've got the cute little plastic joist hangers to hold it up. But in a retrofit situation like this, you can see what's happened in this case is a lot of it has fallen down. And some of it's just lying on the ground and some of it's just tipped over like this, making a great rodent runway up to the remaining foil-faced board. Clearly, a lot of this not effective at all, just in case it was to begin with, okay? We don't know because, again, you've got to make sure that you're providing a still airspace in order for the reflective part of this product to work. And clearly, once you compromise the joy space, by one piece falling down, you've compromised the joy space for the entire width of the home. So this kind of application, I would suggest, not really good. The other difficulty, of course, with this is, assuming that you've put them all up nicely, is that you have lost visibility to all your underfloor infrastructure, the pipes, the wires, the data cabling, if you have that, the speaker wires, all disappeared. Okay, so I don't think that that's a good implementation. Another thing that we've found from time to time under a floor are products that were really meant for somewhere else. So this particular product looks to me like what's called a builder's blanket. So a fiberglass blanket faced with aluminium foil. And typically it goes over roof battens and under the roofing irons. Here it looks like someone's had some left over, or for I don't know what the original idea was, but they put it on the floor. It's not really going to be the right width. They've held it up with some wire mesh, and they've tried to hold it up. Clearly some of it refuses to be held up. And you can see that this, I don't know if it was ever effective or if this is effective, but clearly ineffective here, ineffective over here and in the back there. It's just not a good idea to use some other product that you've got left over or is cheap to do your underfloor insulation. Someone has gone to a lot of trouble to put this up, a lot of expense, a lot of labor, and they've used a really cheap material that's not meant for this application, and there's the result there. Okay, so really better to avoid doing these kinds of things in the first place. There's some other stuff that's fallen down here. Again, here, look, anything, I don't know if any of it is really effective, but a lot of it is not effective, that's for sure. Now, another thing that's happened is with glass fiber bats. In this particular instance, there has been a really prolonged rodent attack on this underfloor. So glass fiber bats are made with tiny little glass fibers gathered together and glued together. That makes it very easy for rodents to scratch at it, sometimes actually eat it, but scratch at it, pull it apart, go and take it away for nesting material. Okay? So this underfloor, again, someone's gone to a lot of trouble to put it up with various kinds of wiring, and you can see the result. It's just an awful, awful result here. It's certainly not effective. Look at that. You can see the floor. It's all hanging down. A lot of it's on the ground. Look, they've even put chicken wire under it. Don't use chicken. It's for chickens. It's just not effective. It's a lot of trouble to put up. It's terrible to use in a tight place like this. And, you know, I don't think this was ever effective underfloor anyway. And this is one of our installers taking all this down, which was quite an undertaking. And you can see a really unpleasant experience. So that's what happened in this case with glass fiber bats. Is it going to happen with other glass fiber bats? I don't know. And probably you don't know either. So if you're thinking of using glass fiber, just remember this and consider whether that's likely to happen in your own place as well. Here's the other side of the spectrum. So here we've got really good quality polyester roll material, but the fixing method is very poor. What we've relied on here, well, we haven't, but what the installer has relied on here is friction fitting and some strapping. And neither of those is good. Anything that's friction fitted will be defeated by gravity. There's no question, it's just how long is it going to stay friction fitted before it ends up on the ground. But everything that's friction fitted is going to end up on the ground. Strapping usually doesn't work very well either, and that's because for two reasons. One is the strapping is going to always be slightly hanging down, and secondly, strapping, there's never enough strapping in order to hold the material up, and that's what you can see here. Okay, so there's one strap, there's a pipe holding up some of the material. Is the pipe holding it firmly against the floor? Well, we don't know. But the rest of the material, friction fitted, is falling down. There's another photo. So ineffective, 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 ineffective. Really, someone's paid a good amount of money for this really good quality material, and it's just been wasted by an ineffective fixing method. And you can see that it's stretching the strapping here, it's stretching the strapping here. It's like strapping is not a good fixing method. And finally, spray foams. I don't have any pictures of spray foams, which is a bit of a shame, but I have seen various spray foam implementations. And we can say this, there are advantages to spray foam. The main advantage is it achieves a complete cover because the spray foam expands over everything, and it's going to provide a complete airtight solution. So there will be no draft through your floor. And it's likely to be, I don't know, but it looks like it's going to be a permanent solution as well. So they're the good things. The downside of that is they're unable to insulate really tight spaces. That's because you're using a spray gun, and so you can't use a spray gun next to your face. So really tight spaces are not viable for spray foam. The main thing, though, is that the spray foam does do a complete cover, so it's going to cover all your water pipes, all your waste pipes, all your electrical cabling, any data cabling, etc., is going to be forever lost in the foam. In my view, that's a maintenance issue. Okay, so if you need to do any work on these things, A, you have to locate them, and B, then you've got to dig them out of the foam. And having done that, then the foam in those areas, of course, is compromised anyway. So the downside is that it's permanent and it's complete, you know, so it's kind of, two sides of the same coin, really. So I hope that's been helpful to show you some things to avoid. And in the next section, we're going to have a look at, well, how we install underfloor insulation and how you can too.